Dr. Henk de Jong is the director of the Interministerial Interdepartmental Program on Biodiversity in the Netherlands, and I may add the driving force behind TEEB for the Netherlands that we've discussed earlier this week. He's been around in the national government for some time. Since 1992, he has held several management positions in the ministry, dealing with some genetically modified organisms, animal welfare, health and corporate social responsibility. And before he turned into the biodiversity driver, he was the Deputy Director General of International Affairs. Please, Henk, tell us about the Dutch position in this debate.
Thank you, Leon. I'm pleased to speak to you about the policy perspectives on ecosystem services as it has developed in the Netherlands in the past years. And to start with, the interministerial program is a collaboration between the Ministry of Economic Affairs, Agriculture and Innovation, the Ministry of Infrastructure and the Environment, and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Development Cooperation. So there's quite a bunch of people in. I will discuss the policy development in three phases: the pre-Nagoya phase, the new insights from the last 2-4 years, and the future policies as I see them in the period till 2050, which is quite a long term, which was the scope of the TEEB study. In the pre-Nagoya period, the underlying value orientation in biodiversity policy was largely and almost uniquely the intrinsic value of nature, and the focus of policy was on conservation. How did this translate in Dutch policy? We had, of course, our national ecological network, of which I will tell some what more. That was government-steered and financed and directed at habitat and species protection. And that national ecological network consisted of a number of core areas, which were later named, because the policy started much earlier, the Natura 2000 areas. We had a number of corridors connecting them. We had restoration areas in which we developed new nature or restored nature, and there were buffer zones around the core areas to protect them from other kinds of environmental impact like nitrogen. Now, how does that look like? And but this is the National Ecological. I will.
A pointer.
Okay. I was searching for that.
And then you should stay either here or use the microphone.
Yeah. Okay, I have to go back. So this is the National Ecological Network. And it's mainly concentrated here at the coastal area, the Rhine and the Meuse estuary, and here in a large forest area. in the middle of the land. And then you see it's there are a lot of smaller areas all around the country which are connected by quite small connection zones. The government just decided to simplify the national ecological network and finish it in 1980. And the main reason for that there was a continuing budgetary problems. And as all countries in Europe and around the world, we had to cut budget. And the present government made very large budget cuts also in nature conservation. So it was decided to simplify it and finish it because there was a budget shortage of several billions of euros if it would have been finished in its design of the 90s and the early second one century. So what is positive about this policy? It stopped further biodiversity loss in the Netherlands, but that biodiversity already was at a very low level in MSR, mean species abundance terms, at about 14 or 12%. So we were successful in the restoration of wetlands. That's an ecosystem which can develop quite rapidly, and we were successful there. And we were, and I mentioned for those aware, the Oostvaardersplassen as an example. And we were successful in combination on functions. In the 90s, we had a high risk of flooding in the Meuse and Rhine areas, and then it was decided not to heighten up the dikes, or not only to heighten up the dikes, but also to broaden the riverbeds, to give more space to the rivers, and at the same time giving those the inner beds of the rivers back to nature. So we had large-scale nature development over there. What was negatives is that there were continuing conflicts between economic development and nature, resulting in a very big number of law cases holding up all kind of both nature development and economic development. There were budget problems, as I told you before, and the connection between society and nature was also is under pressure, let me put it that way. What were the new insights developing between 1990 or the policy deficits of what were the new insights developing in the last 5 years? Let me put it that way. There were a number of policy deficits. The 1990-2010 policy didn't stop biodiversity loss on a global level, as is evident from the global biodiversity outlook and is evident from the European Union evaluation of the policy. What also was new that we came to the insight that climate change, depletion of fossil fuels, food price crisis, poverty reduction and hunger are all interrelated problems and related to biodiversity, both at the physical and the economic level. Let me make that clear with one example. If you use more land for food, then you have less land for biodiversity. That's what's happening in South America in the moment. And if you use less land for food, then you that may result in higher food prices, leading to again food price crisis and poverty problems. What has changed the mindset in the past years? I think, first of all, that was the TEEP study. I saw the papers here on the table, and if you didn't read them yet, then I strongly recommend you to do it. Then there is the reverse efficiency. In the business community and also in the flagship policy of the European Union, it became evident that the scarcity of natural resources will be a main issue in the coming decades. For instance, Unilever, a large multinational based here in the Netherlands, has half a year ago published a whole new strategic policy of its business, saying that resource efficiency is the main and sustainable resources is the main issue for the company. Then the green growth strategy of the OECD, and then the insight that biodiversity loss, climate change, food security are closely linked, both at the physical and the economic level. And the National Environmental Assessment Agency here in the Netherlands has made a good report on it, which was also presented in Nagoya, Rethinking Global Biodiversity Strategies, and it will also be a main issue at the Rio Plus 20 conference. What does this tell us about future policies? First of all, I think that the value orientation, the pre-Nagoya period, we had a value orientation directed at the intrinsic value of biodiversity, has to change and is changing in the sense that biodiversity, the insight that biodiversity and ecosystems are our natural capital, source of all life and of our economy. That's what the big international companies are telling at the moment. And as a society, we can only flourish if we use them in a sustainable way. And I think that's our important insights, not only brought forward by NGOs, but also by the headrunners in the business community at the moment. In this respect, I also like to point out to the excellent white paper of the United Kingdom, as published this summer, A Natural Choice. What does that mean? What for kind of policies you have to follow based on that value orientation? I think of all, first of all, growing a green economy that is based on renewable resources, closed cycles, and placing the natural capital, including the sustainable use of ecosystem services, at the heart of economic thinking. Second, keep conserving nature, but not only in our nature reserves and ecosystem services, I would add to that, but not only in our nature reserves, but also in cities, agricultural land, and waters. And I want to point out that ecosystem service should also be conserved in our agricultural production system and in waters. We need them. We have to lower the resources we put into agriculture and at the same time increase productivity. That's a task ahead of us. And let me illustrate that with just one example, how crucial that is. Just a few weeks ago, Rabobank issued a report in which it said that in 2050 we will have to increase agricultural productivity fourfold. twofold because of population, global population growth, and other dietary patterns, especially in the developing world, but also twofold because of urbanization, climate change, and degradation of agricultural land, which will result in loss of half of the present agricultural land available. That means that in a very essential part, we are not able to maintain primary productivity, an important, maybe the most important ecosystem service we have in our agricultural areas. So that is a main challenge and a main issue. I see Leo looking at his watch, but I'm almost ready. Now, what kind of, and I think that, no, it's no longer, what kind of approach is needed for that? And then I will make some statements. I think in the past, in the pre-Nagoya period, governments and international organizations had master plans executed by regulation. And the question is, does that work in our present society? And I would say you still need goals and aims, but set by governments and multilateral organizations like the UN and the European Union, but we can't afford to wait by implementing till there is agreement over those plans. And you can't do that only by regulation. What we need is concrete project, bottom-up from business, civil society, local and regional governments. Just let's do that. Thank you.